What's going on, everybody? My name is Trenell here with Todd, but his real name is Up Jump the Boogie. Up Jump the Boogie. Yeah, that is like the best name ever. I don't know how you could. Nobody can ever come up with a better name. Boogie for short. We'll just call him Boogie for short. It is August 28th, and we want to thank you guys for tuning in. We have a correction. Before we actually get into everything, we have a correction from last week. And Todd, can you go ahead and tackle that one?
Yeah, as last week we talked about Final Fantasy 15 being delayed again, but this time only about a month. We struggled a bit about how long it was in development, and we tasked our crack research team, and they come back and let us know that it's been in development for about 11 years.
Crack research team, more like on crack. No. So we fumbled with exactly how long it was in development, but it turns out we were wrong last week, and so we just wanted to set that straight. And 11 years in development, that's a long time for one game, but I feel like there's been games that have been in development longer.
Yeah, there have been.
Two Human 2 or something like that? It was Xbox.
Two Human, yeah, that game was in development for a long time. It was hyped. They were shown at E3 every year.
Everybody was just so hyped for that game. It was garbage.
Yeah, horrible.
It was garbage. That was a 360 game, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it came out on the 360. I remember that. Didn't pick it up. And like when they said it was in development for like 10 years, I was like, I never heard of it. long time for a game to be delayed in development. And then this delay doesn't make it any better. No. But I really hope that, with this delay, it ensures that you get a quality experience. Because I'm still not sold on whether or not I'm even going to get Final Fantasy 15. I thought that it might be something that I wanted, but I played the two demos the two demos that they released, and I just don't like the gameplay.
Right.
I don't like the fighting system.
Yeah, I'm game sharing, and my game sharing partner is going to be getting it, so I will play it.
So you'll get to play it, just not spending that 60 bones for it.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, so. I can understand it if I have somebody that's willing to game share with me, that's definitely how I plan on playing it, because it doesn't seem, I don't know. I don't want to say it's not worth it, but to me, I have not been sold
yet. Right. And so, I'm neither have I, to be quite honest. It's like, it is what it is, I guess. We'll see. I'm not overly excited, that's for sure.
Yeah, so we'll wait on that. But with that, let's just go ahead and jump into our weekly icebreaker. And with all of the news regarding PlayStation Plus that we're going to get into, that's going to be one of our stories, I wanted to start things off and kind of get a gauge of what you think with the discussion of Xbox Live versus PlayStation Plus. And I want to hear what you have to say first, and then I'll give my thoughts.
Well, we can do a whole show about that, but... Mm-hmm. My thoughts, I've always thought Live was a better service. I always thought it's more stable. I mean, people get on it for going down, and people get on it for being charged and so on and so forth. But I always thought it to be a better service. I always felt, at least definitely back in the 360 PS3 days, that the Xbox Live community was a more lively community. Mm-hmm. Part of the reason I believe is that Xbox packaged headsets. PS3 did not. So I thought that gave them a bit of a leg up. I can't really speak for the PlayStation community now. I've been off PlayStation for about a year and a half now. Mm-hmm. So when I was on it, it seemed the same to me. I mean, as it goes, a lot of the games you get on and you were socializing lobbies were pretty dead on PlayStation as opposed to Xbox One to me. But, it's to each his own. I do think both of them are quality services. I think they both offer very good values.
With the free games and everything, and I'm not sure which service decided to do that first, whether it was Xbox or PlayStation, but
that was PlayStation when they first launched it. That was their trump on Xbox Live.
Because initially, and I agree with you for the most part. I've always been an Xbox. That's me. So I was always under the impression that Xbox Live was a superior service, and I never had a problem paying for it. I mean, no. I was paying for Xbox Live back on the original Xbox console with when I was started playing like Halo 2 and stuff like that. So it was always something that never bothered me. So when you get like the PlayStation Xbox argument, people will say, "Oh, well, you have to play for online." But like, yeah, but online is it's good,
right?
It's good. It's a bigger community, and that was always the argument that that would come up. Now we're gonna get into this later, but so let's just go ahead and jump into that story I don't want to go too far in this segment with that argument. So first up on our top five stories for this week is the news on Sony.
Sony's had a busy week.
A busy week on the Sony front. So I'm gonna let you just go down the list here because okay. We have a list of topics here that we can all just talk about.
Okay, so just continuing off the conversation we started, Xbox Live versus PlayStation Plus. One of the big advantages many people perceive was PlayStation Plus was cheaper than Xbox by $10.
Well, first it was free.
Yeah, first it was free.
And then they made it so you had to pay for it, but like nobody seemed to care like when it was announced.
Right.
I remember that E3. It was the launch
of the PS4.
And it was the what was it? Like the announcement for the Xbox One. And when they announced like, okay, we're gonna do we're not gonna allow you to share discs, it's gonna be always on, you need to connect and all that bullshit. When Sony came out and was like, you can share your discs with anybody, and everybody was like, yeah, oh shit. It's like, oh yeah, you're gonna have to pay for PlayStation Plus now. And nobody cared.
Nobody said
cared.
Anything. I remember that.
Nobody said shit. And like I was like, yo, did he just say you have to pay for PlayStation Plus now?
Sony probably started dancing in the back when it heard Xbox with all these restrictions. Like, yes.
All these restrictions and it was more expensive too.
Right. Right. But they announced it was free. I'm sorry, they started charging for it because on the PS3, it was free. You can play online for free, no charge. PS4, they moved to the Xbox model where you had to pay for online play for most games. Not all. There are still some games, and for both systems, I believe, that you can actually play for free.
Really?
Online gaming for free, but it's very far and few in between.
Okay.
On top of that, Sony added the games, the PlayStation Network, free PlayStation Network games. And we got another show on that because I'm not a big fan of what PlayStation is doing with free games. But
dude, it's like every month, dog, it's some kind of puzzle game, it's some kind of space game. Right. Every single month, dude, I'd be checking it. It's like who's making all these space games? I feel like I'm like back in the Atari like 2600 games. Like every single PlayStation Plus game every month has to deal with space, and like they haven't been releasing any kind of like AAA titles. It's all like these like smaller what I would say arcade titles.
Yep.
Something that you would have seen on the previous generation for like Xbox Live Arcade. Like these smaller like $15 games.
Yeah.
Instead of like. Like AAA titles like Rise of the Tomb Raider or like the Gears of War franchise or
something that
Halo Reach. Well, something.
The times they do release a AAA type title, it's a PS3 title.
Right. So, dog. So I'm so pissed. Right. All right. So this month for PlayStation Plus, you were able to on PlayStation 4. There was like some kind of like stupid puzzle, like Tetris type game. Uh-huh. And then there was like some kind of Tetris game. On the PlayStation 3, you can get Yakuza 5.
Yeah,
like, what?
Yeah, oh, I remember we talked about that.
Yeah, we talked about that. And I want to play that game so bad, but it's like, it's not backwards compatible. And that's another thing that Xbox, I'm glad they introduced it because it's really giving them that leg up, man.
It's killing it. Because, I mean, that's one of our stories this week. We'll talk about what Xbox has for next month on Games with Gold.
But, so we'll leave it at there. But, man.
Yeah, so.
Go ahead.
Getting back to the story here. PlayStation Plus is getting a price hike starting on September 20th, I believe is the date. It's going from $50 a year to $60 a year. The monthly and the 3 month charges are. The monthly for $9.99 is the same.
Yeah.
The 3 month used to be $19.99. That's actually going up to $24.99. There's no service edition.
I thought it was already $24 and it was going to $30.
Is that right? I have to. You might be right. I'll check that.
I think the 3 month model is going to go from $24.99
to $29.99. Yeah, that's again, and I said it just previously when we were talking on the Icebreaker. It's still a good value. You get the free game, you get the internet connection, and there's some other stuff that's in there. But wow. The thing is surprising me, and it's been the normal for Sony, for big Sony fanboys, is there's no outreach. Mm-hmm. If this was Microsoft, the world would be on fire.
Yeah, but definitely.
I mean, this, and then on top of that, and they've changed it because, you know, I follow the PlayStation blog and I get some emails and so on and so forth. They kind of hit it in the PlayStation, what's available now on the PlayStation Store. It was a little paragraph at the top. embedded into the PlayStation Store update. They did release a separate blog post to specifically address the price hike, but the initial announcement was buried inside of a secondary inside of another story.
That's how they slip it in there, you know. Right. some shit you don't want to happen is going to happen. We'll tell you in secret. It's like subliminal messaging. Like, right. you'll if you didn't see it coming, like, you,
that's your fault, right?
That's your fault. Yeah. Yeah. And it's crazy because, like, I honestly, like, okay, I will give PlayStation the benefit of the doubt here. They have been using, you know, their, you know, the money wisely, and have been trying to create a community on PlayStation. Right. It's just, for me, it isn't as so number one, for me, the PlayStation 4 interface is just not as user friendly to me. Like, I have trouble finding shit. They have like four separate marketplaces where you can, like, buy games. You have the PlayStation Store, you have the PlayStation Now Marketplace, you have the PlayStation Plus Market. I'm like, where can I find this one thing? Like, it's crazy to me. And, like, that's just my issue with the PlayStation 4. But I will give them the benefit of the doubt. They have been, you know, trying to create these this big community. Right. But for somebody like me, I don't really see the worth in PlayStation Plus. Well, and I definitely don't see I don't see where it warrants an extra $10 a year.
I look at it this way, the back end. So they have stable, the service is up, it's barely any downtime, the servers are stable. There's no month-long outage, you know, remember that, right? From what, 2012?
Oh, wow.
When it got hacked, remember that?
I remember.
Yeah, yeah, so there's no month-long outage in anything like that. So, I mean, there is cost when they want to run these type of services, and I understand that. And $60 a year, come on, man, that's nothing.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's nothing, but it's like, but here's my argument. You're paying the $60 a year, right? Yeah. You're going from $50 to $60 a year. You're still not getting the entire experience, because if you want to play PlayStation 2 games, you need PlayStation Now, and that's an additional $30.
Or more, yeah.
Or more, or whatever. So it's like, dang, I got this service, but there's like a service within this, like, it's crazy.
Right. As it stands right now, $60 to $60 for a PlayStation Plus and Xbox Live. Xbox Live, in my opinion, is the better value, and is mainly because of backwards compatibility.
Compatibility, and they just created something really special on the 360. And that has just, you know, kind of just carried over. So you have the community. You have the games for gold, which are actual games that people want to play.
Right.
Like,
right.
You know, like, okay, this was a bestseller on the 360.
Right.
Let's make it a game for gold.
And the difference between last gen and current gen games, at least at this point, aren't to the point where you're not going to pick up a last gen game and not play it. If it's something you really wanted to play.
Right. If it's something that you really wanted to play and you can get it for free, like, I'm there. Like, I didn't play Halo Reach. Mm-hmm. But it was a game for gold, so I'm like, yeah, let's do it, man.
Yeah, yeah. I heard Reach was pretty good, actually.
Yeah, it's okay. It's pretty good. I played the multiplayer back in the day. I wasn't I didn't like how similar they were trying to make it to Call of Duty at the time. So,
right.
But that's another video. So another discussion.
So let's move on with Sony.
Yeah.
there's more Sony. There's actually
there's a huge ton. Yeah, there's a lot of Sony.
Big, huge leak this past week. All the videos now have been, I've watched the video. I watched actually the unboxing before it was taken down. But there was a unboxing of the new PlayStation Slim, which is presumably going to be announced in on September 7th at the PlayStation
event. At the event, yeah.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, I'm going to the link now. That thing is gone.
yeah. All of the stuff is, they've been taking it down. They've been hitting the pitch. I mean, the pictures pop up real quick. The videos, though, that, man, those things are getting whack-a-mole quick. But, I mean, it's definitely a working PlayStation 4. And unless PlayStation's, unless Sony has some kind of crazy trick, all their bills have been, all their beans have been spilled.
So, how does that happen, though?
That's crazy. I don't know. And it's not just one. From what I've been reading, it's like three or four of them. People were just straight up buying them. I have no idea. I don't know if some dude from the factory just grabbed a bunch and started selling them because he knew he could sell them for big money. Uh-huh. But, dude, it's like four or five of them that are out. I mean, And to be quite honest, I looked at the design. It looks, the PlayStation 4 as it's designed now is a beautiful machine. Mm-hmm. This PlayStation Slim, it's cheap.
I don't like it. It looks cheap. I'm looking at the pictures right now. It's like it looks weird. It looks like I don't even know what to call this.
I don't know either. It just looks like the $50 Android phone sitting next to a Samsung Galaxy. It just looks cheesy. And that's disappointing because Sony, They have been pretty good with, well, I take that back because the PlayStation 3 Slim was kind of bougie looking too.
Well, the PlayStation 3, the OG PlayStation 3 was retarded. That thing, I don't know what least, they were thinking with that.
At least it looked pretty, right? This thing's got the same crappy plastic junk as the PlayStation 3 Slim had. I don't like it. I didn't like it then. I don't like it now.
Yeah.
And So,
yeah, I definitely don't like this design that I'm looking at. I can't actually pull up any videos. It looks like they all have been taken down, but I do have the images, and that thing it looks weird.
It's odd. It's a square box. It has the requisite USB power and eject buttons on the front. It's just odd. It looks like a sandwich. I don't know.
It looks like a sandwich.
It's just weird. I don't know.
I don't know what to say about the design, but that's wild. That so many people got their hands on them.
Yeah, this is. I've never seen anything like that. I've seen games get street date broken, and they've been like. The game's been announced. Everybody knows about it. It's usually been a week or so, but an unannounced device that's out in the public's hands, that's wild.
They didn't even get a chance to announce it, and it's like out there.
And the thing is, and I've read some op-ed pieces, then people are like, hey, look, Sony, the beans are spilled. Just acknowledge it.
Yeah, just acknowledge it and put it out there. Like, are they still going to try and have this
No, we're going to keep it under wraps until September. Well, you know what? No.
I mean, I'm sure that this wasn't the only thing that they had to talk about at their event coming up.
Right.
But I would think that this is a big one.
Right.
And I don't even understand the purpose of the PlayStation 4 Slim. Like
That's just part and parcel. They always do that. It's Xbox.
Well, yeah, that's something that they always do. But then it's not just about like slimming it down, making it faster anymore. It's about like, okay, this is a updated version, like doing better shit than the original.
See, we don't know that. So during the unboxing, they didn't see any new features to it.
But I'm saying like we already know that they're coming out with that
with the Neo. Right.
So the Neo is another PlayStation 4. And like everybody was getting on Microsoft, like, oh well, you got the Xbox One S, and then you have Project Scorpio. I think it's too many consoles, man. It's a lot going on.
There's still quite a few. I mean, there's still quite a ton of people that don't have either Xbox or PlayStation 4. So now having the Xbox S. Xbox One S or PlayStation 4. That's just newcomers or it's like somebody that's on one side that wants to try the other side to get another system, right? Without having to wait for, you know, not necessarily wanting to wait for their Project Neo. The unboxing, the guy that unboxed it was a guy I watched. He unboxed it. I mean, it's just a PlayStation 4. There's no new features.
Features.
That you can tell.
Does it even run?
That doesn't necessarily mean that there's no new features because the Xbox One S, day one patch to get 4K to work and HDR to work. So it could be the same thing with the PlayStation Slim.
That's
the PS4 Slim, there's a day one patch that's going to get some additional features. And that may be why Sony has not said anything because they know there's more to it than just it being a PlayStation 4. And I hope there is.
Yeah, it would be dumb if it was just a Slim PS4 because I feel like that way of updating the consoles has been shattered.
It would be quite embarrassing considering what Microsoft has done.
Yeah. I mean, it would be very embarrassing. And I feel like that going that route was something that would have worked last generation and is not a thing in this generation.
No, definitely. It needs to be some kind of incremental upgrade, right?
Incremental upgrade. Yeah.
Something.
That's what it seems to be about.
Yeah. So we'll see what they have to announce. It's a week away, right? Just a little bit over a week. So we'll see. And
we'll definitely report it to you when it happens.
Yeah.
I can't believe it.
A whole system and somebody.
A whole system.
That's like somebody getting an iPhone 7 today when we know it's not going to be announced until next month. That's what? How's that happen?
But the thing is, like, you know the iPhone 7 is coming. Nobody knew this was coming.
Yeah, nobody knew the PS4 Slim was coming. That's for sure.
Nobody knew this.
We all were waiting for, sitting on our hands waiting for this Neo announcement, and there's a PS4 Slim, so.
That's crazy. Let's go ahead and move on. What we got next? We're still going down the list. More Sony news.
More Sony news. So you got a PC, got at least a 5 meg internet connection, and you want to play some PS3 games? PS Now is coming to your Windows PC. And I emphasize Windows because it doesn't seem like there's a Mac version. It's coming to Windows PCs. PS, if you're not sure what it is or don't know what it is, PS Now is Sony's streaming gaming service, almost like OnLive. They actually bought the company that was called Gaikai. They bought Gaikai to do the streaming service. It's about 400 titles available now. Most of them are PS3 games.
Not worth it. It's $30 a month.
Yeah.
Is it $30 a month?
$30
or a
year? For 3 months, I think, is what
it
is.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, $24.99.
Not worth it.
I don't know.
It should be included in PlayStation Plus within the 60. It should be included in the subscription, man.
I've had that argument before. And the reason it's not included is because it's the same reason Netflix doesn't do blockbuster movies. They have to pay those fees. They have to pay those licensing fees to the customer.
But it's basically just like last gen games. So you're basically making people pay for backwards compatibility, quote unquote.
Yeah,
basically. And I don't. I think it's stupid. I think to separate it, and you know, instead of just calling it like, okay, this is the way that we do backwards compatibility is by streaming, like separate it into its own service just guarantees that nobody's gonna fucking do it.
Right.
I'm not gonna pay $30 more when I already pay you $60 a year just to play PS3 games. Like,
right.
And then it's not even good ones. There's nothing on there, man.
There's nothing on there.
There's nothing on there, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's if you want to play your play, if you loved your PlayStation 3 and you miss your PlayStation 3 games, you should still have your PlayStation 3.
Exactly. I still have my Xbox 360. I still have my OG Xbox for the games that weren't backwards compatible on the 360. So it's like, there's games that I like. I'm not going to get rid of the console because they're going to make you pay.
Yeah, and I'm looking at the PlayStation. So it's 1 month. If you do month by month, it's $19.99. And if you do 3 months subscription, it's $44.99. So it's $20 a month or $45 every 3 months. That's like $980 a year, up to $240 a year. Woof.
That's expensive for video games, man.
Yeah, and it is. No, thank you.
No, thank you.
Thank you.
Make the system backwards compatible, man. I feel like I feel like Sony announced the PlayStation Now, and then Xbox was just like, all right, let's hit the Switch. Click, back to compatibility.
Compatibility, right, yeah.
For free, included in your live subscription.
Right.
And it's awesome.
It works. I mean, it works. Some games.
It works, and they are just continuously adding more and more games to the service. And then each game that comes out for Games for Gold for the 360 is already backwards compatible.
Oh, yeah, always backwards compatible.
Always awesome. Backwards compatible. That's so it's like awesome. Instead of getting
two games. You get four.
Yeah, you get four games. Four games a month.
You have two Xbox One games, two Xbox 360 games. You can't beat that.
You can't beat it. So let's step back for a sec. There is where I say the extra jump to $60 isn't, I don't see it being worth it for PlayStation.
For PlayStation, right.
Because I feel like you don't get nearly as much.
I agree. Yeah. The value proposition for Xbox One, Xbox Live versus PS Network, Xbox Live is by far, not by far, but it is the better value in my opinion.
Yeah, it's the better value just based on what you get like right off the bat. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Right off the bat.
Yeah.
So what else we got? We're still in Sonyville.
More Sony news. Capcom has a Humble Bumble release a Capcom bundle for PlayStation. Amazingly great unless you have a PS4. Well, so what you're getting, there's the Pay What You Want tier, which gets you Strider, which actually is a pretty fun game.
That's a cool game. I beat that one.
PS4, PS3. Then you get Final Fight, Double Impact, PS3. Wolf of the Battlefield, or Commando 3, it was a PS3 game. Super Puzzle Fighter 2, Turbo HD Remix, thank you Capcom, for a PS3 game. It's a PS3 game. And then you can get a coupon for 45% off of Street Fighter V out of the PlayStation Store, which I think that's worth it just there right there, 45% off.
Yeah, but if you're into Street Fighter and you haven't already bought it, like
you're not gonna want it, right?
You're probably not gonna get it.
Right.
Then, at least not until they add a few new characters. Maybe if you can hold off on it for a while, that I think it'll be worth it.
Coupons only valid until October 1st.
Not worth it.
The next tier gets you Resident Evil for the PS4 or PS3, Mega Man 9 and 10 PS3, Okami PS3, Remember Me PS3, Super Street Fighter 2 Turbo HD Remix PS3, Lost Planet 3 PS3. Are we developing a pattern here?
And see, this is the thing, man. If this was an Xbox One, all of these games would be available on the Xbox One. Mm-hmm. This is ridiculous. It's like, okay, so the Humble Bundle, so far, only
two PS4 games.
Two PS4 games, and then 45% off off a third.
And then the last tier, I should say, gets you Resident Evil 0, PS4, PS3,
okay.
Devil May Cry Collection, PS3, and 50% off the Mega Man Legacy Collection in the PlayStation Store, which is also valid until October 1st. So you get, there's 12 games. Only three of them are PS4 games, nine are PS3 games. The Humble Bundle is for charity. So the proceeds do go to charity, which is great.
Okay. So that's great. I'm all about the Humble Bundle. I just recently, it was a couple weeks ago, about a month ago.
Mm-hmm.
I got the Sonic the Hedgehog Humble Bundle.
Yeah, you're telling me.
And that was dope. All the games available on my PC, as if I already didn't have like six copies of each one already. But this you can't even enjoy all of what this bundle has to offer,
right?
Unless you have both consoles.
Unless you still have your PS3.
It was ridiculous.
Yeah. I don't know.
Some of these are really cool games. Super Puzzle Fighter is awesome.
Yep.
Okami
is a good
double
game.
What's it called? Final Fight? Okami?
Yeah, Okami.
That is what? Okami HD? Yeah. Oh my god. That's worth this bundle right there.
I would pay
$12 just for Okami HD.
Mm-hmm.
And just everything else you just get, you know, just as a byproduct, but come on. And then Devil May Cry, I would pay $15 for the Devil May Cry collection and Resident Evil, but it's like, man.
If you have a PS4, you do get three games. You can get up to three games. And remember, this is for charity. It's not for your gaming enjoyment. Give to charity. It's the charity to Save the Children, American Red Cross, and RettSyndrome.org. So definitely take advantage of it anyway. And
you know, I would say if you have a PlayStation 3, this is definitely worth it. Definitely worth it. You know, you're gonna get some really awesome games with this bundle for just $15. But for the PlayStation 4, I really don't see the value in it. You're gonna get, you're not getting much.
Yeah,
it's, Resident Evil and Strider is pretty much it.
Yeah, Strider is hella fun though. I will give you that. Strider is fun.
Strider is dope. Yeah,
I have it on Xbox One. It is one of the games I used to play. I remember that from Sega Genesis days. Mm-hmm. Strider, yeah.
Yeah, I never really played the old school ones. I think the first time I even heard of Strider was like when he was introduced to the Marvel versus Capcom series.
Oh, really?
And then I was like, oh, he's cool. Then when they announced that they was making a Strider game, I got it on Steam, and I just cranked that one out, beat it in a long weekend. Like I had a Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
It's only about 6 to 8 hours of gameplay.
Yeah, it's not a terribly long, but right. I loved it. It was fun.
It's definitely a good game. There's some good games on there, but if you're a PlayStation 4 only player, don't expect to get more than three games. If you still have your PS4, if you still have your PS3 and you have a PS4. Or if you just have a PS3 right now, I mean,
definitely do it.
Yeah, I mean, there's some great games in here, which is nice.
Yeah, I would definitely do it. Remember Me? Not an awesome title. I did play and beat that one. I was really hyped for it when I first heard about it, but yeah, it's very meh.
Yeah,
but Okami, dope. Oh,
yeah, Okami is dope. Yeah, definitely.
Do it for Okami, man.
Yeah, that's a great game.
Hashtag Clover Studios. Rest in peace of those boys. Well, no, they're platinum now. So.
Yeah, they're platinum, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, our last Sony story. Let's get this over with.
Yeah, the last Sony story is back to PlayStation Network or something. To secure yourself, they've added two-factor authentication onto your Sony PlayStation network account. So when you get those rogue Russians hacking in your account to buy FIFA cards, you know, because you're going to get you can set up two-factor, you get the text, and you know somebody's trying to log in from somewhere else. So that's always great. Two-factor is always great to have, depending on how you set up. I use two-factor, but I actually use an authenticator app. I didn't see where the authenticator app was added. I do know they added SMS, but I for most of my stuff I use an authenticator app because I don't want random people logging into my stuff.
Right. Yeah. You never want that. So I think out of all of the stories dealing with Sony, this is like the best news for them. I feel like everything else has been either bad news. Or like just like disappointing news,
right?
Because like, man, I can't even express how much PlayStation would benefit if it just embraced backwards compatibility. Man, it's like, ah, man, because you got people that the only way that they could get the PlayStation 4 is that they give up their PlayStation 3, you know, with a trade in or
right something or
whatever.
Like, yeah.
So a lot of these people don't have these consoles anymore, and then you come up with these cool bundles or these cool like free games every month, and nobody has the system.
And you can't play them.
Can't play them on your brand spanking new PlayStation 4. Can't play Yakuza 5. That just pisses me off, man.
Yeah, I do remember that when Xbox or when Microsoft announced backwards compatibility, Sony, I forgot who it was exactly, but he's like, I didn't think it can be done. So that tells me where Sony stands with their backwards compatibility.
I mean, but they have Gaikai. I don't know why they just didn't use that as a way to do backwards compatibility. And you know what? That's what I thought initially.
That they were going to do. Yeah, that's what most people thought.
The case.
Right.
But then you like they want to charge you a separate fee just to play Resident Evil 5. I'm like, no, I'm not gonna do that.
A high expensive fee, freaking $20 a month. Get out of here.
$20 a month. I thought it was 30. I think they reduced the price.
It might have been. You might be right.
I think when I looked, the first time I looked at it, I think it was $30, and I was like, no.
Oh, and then one thing we did skip, and this was announced with the PS. One more Sony story. Mm-hmm. This was announced with the PS Now coming to PC stories. PlayStation is used to has released a USB adapter for your PC, so you can use your DualShock controller on your PC while you're playing PlayStation Now.
Okay, so this is just an official one, because people have already been doing it.
Well, apparently you can use there's been dongles, but you can use USB too. You can just use a USB plug.
Yeah, you can just use a USB plug, and then for some games that don't support PlayStation controllers, you have to like map it as a Xbox controller or whatever, because Xbox controllers are like the controller for PC.
For PC, yeah.
So if you want to use a PlayStation 4 controller, you got to use like some kind of third-party
adapter or program.
A program, and it'll basically mimic an Xbox controller as your PlayStation 1.
So that's that, and I think it's $24.99 for this wireless adapter, and it works on both PC and Mac. You have that as well. So
okay, well. I don't know, man. I feel like because I'm playing Street Fighter right now, Street Fighter V, and I'm using a official like PlayStation controller, not compatible with Street Fighter V online. It's crazy. I have to use a separate program.
So you play on PC?
Yeah, I play on PC with a PlayStation controller that will work on the PlayStation 4, but it doesn't work on PC.
So they
need to come out with something, because. You know, you get into situations like this, where you have like a controller that you want to use,
and you can't,
you know, not officially, I guess.
Right. Well, but you can always just get yourself an Elite controller and chuck that PlayStation DualShock crap where it belongs. That's one thing about Sony PlayStation. The thing that kills me with the PlayStation is the controller, because I have abnormally long thumbs, and they. Okay. I get cramped. They start cramping because they're both in the middle, and where I contort my thumbs, they start cramping after about a good 45 minutes. I'm like, I'm done. So
I actually don't have a problem with the DualShock 4. It's actually not a bad controller.
Yeah, it's a good controller. It feels good in the hand. It's just the way they have the analog sticks. When I'm I'll stub my thumbs, man. I can't deal with it. So. Yeah, definitely. Once I do get my PlayStation 4, I'll be getting a Titan adapter. You know, the Titan USB adapter. It'll allow me to use my Xbox controller.
Oh, wow. No, I didn't.
PlayStation 4.
Oh, that's dope. Yeah. I didn't know nothing about that.
Definitely getting one of those.
Okay. Because do you have the Elite controller?
I do, yes.
Okay. So, yeah, you definitely going to want to use that. Yeah, that shows $150. You better use it.
I use it all the time.
Yeah. Use that show all the time. Yep.
And I don't let anybody else touch it either. Hands off.
Yeah. Put that junk back in the sealed case. It's vacuum sealed. Ain't nobody touching it. But yeah, let's go ahead and get on to the next story. And something that, because I'm actually playing this game, and it's Deus Ex, Mankind Divided. And as far as the PC, it's been having some trouble. With just about every PC launch that we've spoken about on this podcast
has had trouble. Another multi-plat launch, another PC debacle.
Yeah. So I haven't really looked into what some of the problems were, but I think the main one was like frame drops and
There were frame drops. There was an issue with the mouse controls where the mouse controls were all messed up. Mm-hmm. There's a couple other things. I don't know why they do this to the PC.
Yeah.
Is it
the same case where what's his name? Eidos Montreal? Like, did they not develop the PC version? Is that the case?
I don't think so. I'm that one I'm not sure of.
Okay.
But so they've had the issues that they had crashes, they have freezings, they have more crashes.
Okay.
They had a big issue with mouse tracking. Okay. They did release a patch. I think the patch went out Thursday. That fixed most of the main issues.
Okay.
So there's that. They did at least get it fixed fairly quickly. But, I mean, I don't understand why these developers or why these publishers can't get their games out on the PC properly.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I've been playing it on the Xbox One. I'm playing Deus Ex on Xbox One, and I have noticed a few issues. My game has, like, frozen, like, on, like, two occasions. I also had an issue with one of my game saves where, like, one of my auto saves, like, when I loaded it up, it loaded, but I didn't have any of my my items. Like, all my whole inventory was just wiped clean. And luckily, I had a save that wasn't too far back that I can just, like, reload that, and that worked. But, man, that was crazy. I was like, yo, where is all my stuff? I didn't have any of my upgrades. My inventory was wiped clean. I had no ammo, like, no guns, no nothing. So I was very concerned at that point. But luckily, I just had a separate save that I was able to just load up. In addition to that, a couple, like, graphical errors. There was this one part where in a cutscene, it was an in-game cutscene, and this guy was just, like, holding an invisible gun. He was just, like, pointing at me, just, like, pointing his hands at me. I'm like, why is that guy not holding his gun? So was weird. But other than that, few frame drops. But other than that, I'm having a blast with this game, man. Oh, it is so good. It's so good.
I've been watching you. And
yeah, I've been streaming it.
That's definitely a game for me to watch and not to play. Because I would have lost interest like 2 hours, 3 hours into the game. I'd have been done.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not really into stealth games like that. But it's something about like the story. Or the way they tell the story, you know, the main character. I love the main character, Adam Jensen. He seems just like this really cool, like, android, like, killing machine. Oh, God, it's just good, man. I am definitely enjoying myself, but it's good that they patched it up on the PC, and I'm not sure what it's gonna take for, you know, these companies to, you know, release these PC versions of these games, you know, correctly. Like, they have to be, there shouldn't be any issues with the PC version. I don't even know what to say about it at this point.
I would think, because PC is the easiest to develop for, you would think, right? all you need is a baseline.
Yeah.
I
think it may be one of those cases where they weren't directly responsible for the PC version. They handed it off to somebody else to port over or something. Because other than that, I'm not sure what to make of this, man. And it's why I haven't really bought any AAA titles on my PC since since Mortal Kombat X. I have not bought a AAA title on PC, and it's actually crazy because I think they just re-released a Mortal Kombat XL back on PC, and I'm not sure I'm not sure if I actually have access to
because
I didn't get a refund because I had played the game for more than an hour. But yeah, I'm not even sure if I have access to it, or if you have to, like, buy it again. Like, I don't even know.
You should check that out.
Yeah, let me check it out real quick.
Yeah, and while you're doing that, the PC version was not developed by Eidos Montrose. It's developed by Nixxis Software.
No, I've never heard of any of those.
That's who it is. Nixxis Software, Nixxes. That's who did Mankind Divided for PC.
Okay.
So, I mean, just looking at a couple of their projects, they did Rise of the Tomb Raider. They did Lara Croft. They did Thief, Tomb Raider Definitive Edition, Tomb Raider Hitman Absolution. They did The Last Deus Ex, A Human Revolution. They did a lot. They did a lot of all of these are PC games. Kane and Lynch 2, Lovecraft, Tomb Raider, another Tomb Raider, Legacy of Kane, Blood Omen, Soul Reaver, Soul Reaver 2, Mad Dash. So they've been doing games.
Okay.
And they got the Rise of the Tomb Raider 20-year collection that's coming up soon too. Comes out the 11th. But that's PS4.
Okay. Well, yeah, it looks like they're in open beta for XL on the PC.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if I were to reinstall it, it would be the XL beta. So that's actually pretty cool.
That's cool.
But yeah, I'm still scarred for life. I get my triple A's on one of my two current gen consoles. Yeah.
Yeah, because they just give the PC no love anymore.
Yeah, it's unless it's just riddled with issues.
Unless it's a straight PC title.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the AAA titles that come out for the platform, all three platforms, the PC ones always seem to be getting the shaft.
Right. Yeah, it's crazy. You know, back in the day, when you see reviews, you would see reviews for all three versions. The PC version would be reviewed the highest,
right?
Or, with about a 0.2 or 0.3 point margin or whatever, just because it runs better than the other two. And you get all the little comparison videos where they show you, the graphics running on PlayStation, graphics running on PC and Xbox. And PlayStation and the PC version is usually the one that runs the best.
Right.
But just this generation, man,
it's not it started last gen.
Well, yeah.
It's more pronounced. Well, let me say it this way. Not every game, but every big game that comes out. Every game that has a lot of press behind it, a lot of anticipation. When those games hit the PC, they've been not doing so well.
Yeah, not doing too well. In related news, as far as Deus Ex is concerned, there is a DLC controversy going on, and it's kind of stupid. It's really ridiculous. I clicked on the link here, and it basically says they have tons of these microtransactions,
right,
that you can buy. Now, I'm looking at them here, and from what I'm seeing, it's all credits. You can get, in credits in Deus Ex, Mankind Divided is, mm-hmm, the currency you can, right, use to buy stuff. Yeah, to buy stuff. And they have one that costs $1, one that costs $5, one that costs $10.
Mm-hmm.
And each one you get 1,000, 5,000, or 15,000 credits. But the thing is, you can only buy this once. So it's they're doing microtransactions, but they're not even doing it right.
Well, that's not where the issue comes in. The issue comes in, they have the packs, right? They have one that's, right, they have the assault pack, the praxis pack, the tactical pack.
Yeah, yeah.
What have you. And what's happening apparently is you get the skin, you get an augmentation, and you get your custom skin, tranquilizer rifle, game specific augmentation, and that high level ammo. You get the ammo to use with the weapon.
Okay.
And the thing is, once you use it once, you can't get the ammo again. So you can get, say you go through a playthrough, right? You buy your microtransaction, you get the gun, and you get the augmentation, you get the ammo. You go through the playthrough. Say you want to go through the playthrough without killing anybody. That's your first playthrough, right?
Okay.
And then you want to go through a second playthrough where you want to just run through and go ham and just kill everybody you see. The problem is, you get your rifle, you get the augmentation, the higher level ammo can no longer be used.
So that's what I'm saying. They're not even really doing this right.
Right. It's one time.
It's a one-time microtransaction purchase. And it's weird. Because it's if you're going to do microtransactions, you should be able to, buy as many as you want. You want to milk that. But, mm-hmm, that just seems dumb.
And they're pointing the fingers at the platform holders. Mm. They pointed the finger at Sony and Microsoft. The quote was, the ones that are limited are due to, in quotes, first party constraints. They didn't specify, the community manager said this. He posted something on Reddit in response to the outcry there, because, you know, that's the first place everybody goes to whine.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God. Shots fired. Shots fired.
But, yeah, the community manager posted on there and said it's first-party constraints without adding any specifics. I don't know. I've not seen this in any other games for any of the other platforms. So, yeah, I would like to hear more about that, but whatever.
Yeah, because usually when you have these kind of microtransactions, you can buy them multiple times. Right. Like, but
you can buy them multiple times, but you can't get one. Well, no.
No.
You wouldn't want to buy them all. You can't buy them multiple times, right?
No, you can't. Because this is like, instead of like a microtransaction, like an in-game microtransaction, right, this is just like a one-time DLC. Like
add-on pack.
Add-on. And you can only get it once, but it doesn't make sense that you can only get that once, because like once you run out of that ammo type, it's gone.
Right.
So that's stupid.
It's odd.
I feel like that's something that they're gonna patch. They have to.
I don't know. I would not be surprised if they didn't. What I would tell anybody that's playing Deus Ex, Trenell, don't buy the DLC.
Don't
buy the packs.
No.
Just leave it. Let it be.
I haven't gotten a season pass since Batman Arkham Knight.
Oh, come on.
So got burnt on season passes. I'm not doing those no more.
You don't do season pass. I do all the season passes, man.
Nope. Well, the only way I'll get a season pass is if it comes with a special edition.
Like the collector's edition game.
Like if I buy a collector's edition of a game, it comes with a season pass. Okay, I got the season pass.
That's how I used to buy the games.
Other than that, no. I don't do season passes, and I don't do... I don't do PC AAA games.
Oh,
I'm just getting burned, man. Tired of getting burnt.
Don't blame me, because I do season. What I typically do with a game, like for one, I don't just randomly go out and buy games. A game I've never heard of, like new IPs or something I'm not too sure about, I just buy the game. But something like, for instance, Battlefield 1, I'm a big Battlefield fan. Battlefield 4 was my game. Battlefield 3 before that, I played tons of both of those. Hardline, garbage.
That was garbage. I played that one.
But Battlefield 1, I'm really, from what I say, I'm really excited. So I brought that with the battle pack. I pre-ordered that with the battle pack.
Okay.
I mean, the season pass, I should say. But usually games, when I bought Destiny, I bought the collector's edition with the season pass, because I enjoyed the beta.
Yeah. I mean, I bought Halo with the collector's edition, mm-hmm. came with the season pass. So yeah, I haven't had a problem with games that I want,
right,
and I know I'm going to be putting a whole lot of time into. But
it's just like random games that are just, especially single-player games like a Deus Ex. I struggle with wanting to buy. I have to see what the pack is going to be, because the season
pass. Oh, yeah, and then like a lot of times you don't even know what the season pass is going to include.
Right.
And then if you don't get it, like for the case with Fallout, like they'll hike that price up. So I think right now the season pass is like $40. Or something like that for the season pass.
The Battlefield 1 season pass is like $49.99. I saw that. I was like, are you serious? That's crazy.
Yeah.
They used to be, they went from $30 to $50 just like that. That's ridiculous.
Oh, man. What was that one game? Oh, man. It was I think it was a Battlefield game, it may have been that Star Wars game where the DLC or the season pass was like $50.
Yeah, it's I think you're right. Battlefront 2. Yeah, Battlefront for Star Wars. Yeah, because I wasn't sure about Star Wars Battlefront. I bought it, and I liked it. I didn't buy any of the season pass. I mean the DLC. But this new one that came out is the one with the Death Star in it. I wanted it. Right. It's like $20. I'm not paying $20. I'm going to go get the season pass, because the season pass should be $30. Hell no, that shit was $50. Like what?
$50.
Like,
that's almost
on,
the price of the game.
Yeah, like, I wouldn't have sold the game.
Damn.
It's like, fuck that. I'm done.
Yeah, so I don't know. For somebody that's actively playing Deus Ex, I haven't beaten it yet. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty close to beating it. But as someone that is playing the game, I have no intentions on buying any of the microtransaction DLC. The only thing that I would get is story DLC. That's it. So I'll get the story DLC whenever that comes out. I don't mind paying, you know, the $20 as opposed to paying $30. I don't care. I don't want the season pass. I'll get what I want when it is available. When it comes out. I'm not buying into the season pass. Not doing it.
So next story, and I'm going to let you run with this.
Yeah, so the next story that we have, more DLC related. So we just talked about DLC. And this is the DLC for Dark Souls 3. And it's the first story DLC, and it's called, Ashes of what? Ashes of Ariandel. And it's the new story DLC. It's going to be coming out on October 25th on all platforms at the exact same time. And it is included in the season pass.
PC version destined to be broken.
Say what?
I said the PC version is destined to be broken.
Yeah, so I was playing Dark Souls 3. I put it down since I've beaten it. But I haven't sold it because I knew they was going to come out with DLC and I was going to get right back into that world. That is a fun freaking game. And I tell anybody that hasn't, that has never played a Dark Souls before, mm-hmm. that if you're going to jump into it for the first time, I would definitely get Dark Souls 3.
Really?
I feel like with each title, they just become more and more accessible to newcomers.
Got it.
So while I have played Dark Souls 1, and like I gave up. I couldn't do it. It was too freaking hard. I was able to get Dark Souls 3 and go through the entire game. And man, that is a ride right there, man. That is a ride. I love it.
It was an action RPG, right?
Yeah, action RPG. And I forgot exactly what the trailer showed. But I think that you're going to get, like, some new, like, weapons and powers and stuff.
Yeah. I watched the trailer.
Course, you got new bosses. But I think there's new abilities. Yeah, you got new abilities, it looks like. New abilities, new enemies, new bosses. The bosses look crazy, man. Oh, my God. If Dark Souls is good at doing anything, it's intimidating the hell out of you.
It's a pretty game. It looks pretty.
Oh, God, it's freaking beautiful. Yeah, they have this one power where you, like, throw, like, some kind of, like, energy, mm-hmm. and it, like, it goes, and then it comes back. Kind of like you're throwing, like, Captain America's shield or something like that. So that's definitely new in the game. And it's really cool. Then you can fight, like, wolves and stuff. You've never fought wolves in Dark Souls, so that's new. But I'm definitely waiting in anticipation. Oh God, I'm just looking at the trailer. Let me stop. but yeah, I'm definitely waiting on this game to release the DLC, because it just gives me an excuse to just get back into it. You know, I don't really see much point of going back into it now,
right.
because after you beat the game, you can just start the new game plus, and it just ramps up the difficulty, and it just keeps going and going and going. So as it stands, I'm pretty satisfied with what I've played so far, and I cannot wait for the DLC to release so that I can just, like, jump back into that game.
Right. That's cool.
Yeah.
It looks good. Action RPGs. But right now I'm not going to be able to jump or anything. I got my ReCore coming. I got the Destiny coming. I got Mafia 3, which I'm going to try out. Then it's Battle.
Oh, my God, Mafia 3.
Oh, it looks nuts. My brother told me about it, and I've been watching. You know, I've been tracking it. Man, listen, that game looks good.
That game looks really good.
I definitely am going to be getting that. It looks good.
Yeah, that is a very, very good looking game. I did not jump into the Mafia series until after the second game became a Games for Gold. So Mafia 2 was a game for gold, and this was during a time where I had absolutely nothing to play. I had absolutely nothing to play. And so I jumped into it. I fell in love with the game and, you know, its story, its characters. And so I'm definitely getting Mafia 3 when that comes out. I cannot wait for that game.
Yeah, it looks good. It looks really good.
Yeah. All right, so let's go ahead and jump into the next story. And you can go ahead and take this one.
Let's talk about Ubisoft.
Ubisoft! Woo!
Tom Clancy's The Division. This was another game I played, the beta. Uh-huh. I was crazy excited. I pre-ordered the game with the season pass, and I played the game, and I threw up in myself.
But I see. Okay, so I did get into the beta. I got into the beta.
Yeah, you played it.
Yeah, I played the beta. I played the beta on PC. And you know, it seemed tight, man. I was just watching the trailers. I watched it at E3, mm-hmm. and I thought that it was gonna be like something that it totally wasn't. And I feel like Ubisoft has just been giving everybody the okie doke for a very long time. Yeah.
It was definitely a letdown. My biggest problem is, and I may get slack on this, and game designers, you know, I'm not a developer. I don't know what goes into it. Fine, but I thought it was lazy game design, because the game design difficulty mechanics is all about how strong your opponents are or how weak you are. I mean, everybody's a meat. Even the stupid rank and file guys with baseball bats, they run up to you and hit you with twice and you're dead. You pump 30 rounds of shotgun shells in them and they just keep running. Makes no sense.
Yeah, that's my problem with the game. It's you should, no human should take like 6 clips of a freaking like automatic like machine rifle, whatever. Right. Like that, it doesn't make any sense to me, man.
Yeah, you got 215 rounds of LMG bullets. That's nothing. Yeah. They just keep running at you, and it's just ridiculous. The end game is just 100,000 bullet sponges just walking at you relentlessly, throwing. Spamming bombs, spamming guns, fire. Just everything they do is they spam. They just walk at you and they just and constantly shoot, never have to reload. Constantly throwing grenades, constantly dropping bombs, all the while getting shot and walking through it like you're not doing anything.
Yeah.
But
and then the game scales in a way that if you're trying to play with your friends, if your friend is a low level, he's not going to have a good time. He's going to be getting downed at every single shot.
Instantly. Instant downs. One shot downs. Yeah, it's ridiculous.
And it makes it not fun. That's why I can't play it, just because, you know, when I want to play with my friends, you know, have made, either they've been playing. Like when I tried to play with you the last time.
Right.
You know, you're a higher level than me. So like when I try and like, okay, let me do this, help me with this mission. It's not my mission. It's the same mission, but scaled to your level.
Right.
So it makes it so I get wrecked by everybody, even like the henchmen, not even like, you know, boss characters.
Right.
Like,
just the henchmen. Yeah. The rank and files. It's ridiculous.
It's stupid.
But so what Ubisoft has announced is that they're going to skip the upcoming expansion, the first expansion they released, the upcoming expansion, which was supposed to be coming out soon, is being shelved for now. And they're going to fix bugs. And there's a list of known issues. They're going to fix the loot drops, enemy difficulty and time to kill. That is a big, big one right there. That's what we're just talking about. Enemy difficulty and time to kill. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
The solo player experience, I think that goes back to the enemy difficulty, because if the enemies weren't such meat sponges, the solo player experience wouldn't be as horrible. Dark zone and PvP balancing. I stopped going into the dark zone because you got the hardcores that got all the top weapons, and it's just like playing with playing against the computer. You just get one shot down. It's silly. And then there's quality of life additions where they're going to add. They're going to tweak the way inventory works, and they're going to set more gear set and weapon balancing. So what they're basically saying is, we understand our game is a hot mess.
Not what you expected.
And instead of us just pumping out this, because apparently the thing with The Division is it's a great idea, and it's
a solid idea.
Good story. The story I thought was good. Mm-hmm. It was fairly fun to play until you started getting up to the higher levels and you just realized that you can't kill anybody. The level design is simplistic.
It's a cover-based shooter, so it's not too much that goes into it.
Mm-hmm.
But like when you're behind cover and somebody you're shooting at somebody and he's just like walking into the bullets, it's like, well, what the hell am I supposed to do with this?
And spamming grenades, that's the one thing that kills me, is that
infinite
grenades. It's ridiculous. But you know what? I have I brought the game. Like I said, I have the DLC, the season pass, so I will be getting the DLC whether I like it or not. I mean, it's a game. I really like the game. I like the concept. I just don't like the way it plays. And if they can fix it to a point where it's actually playable and enjoyable instead of it being like a task, I'll go back and play it more.
Because I'm always down. I mean, I love third person shooters. Mm-hmm. I'm a huge third person shooter fan. So, you know, if they could, I haven't sold the game yet, which is shocking because I've been to GameStop a few times. And I keep forgetting to bring it with me. so if they fix it before my next trip to GameStop, you know, I have no problem with getting back on it.
Yeah, see, I've actually the last physical media game I bought, I sold it. Star Wars. That was the last one. All my other games I buy digitally, and that's because mainly because I'm game sharing. So
yeah,
if you can't game share if it's not digital, mm-hmm. but I have it. Hopefully they fix it and they play it because it's a shame. And my brother also played and he has the same complaint. He liked the story. Yeah. And my brother he's one of these guys that's like, if the game doesn't have a good story, I'm not going to play it.
But the story is pretty compelling. I enjoyed the story and I enjoy going through most of the, you know, the campaign and, you know, learning about this world.
Right.
And, you know, what happened.
Is a good story. I think it's a good story. The characters are relatable.
Yeah.
The TV show they did was horrible, but that's something else.
Yeah. I think we talked about that before.
But if they can fix the game and make it a little more playable, it's time to kill. That's a major issue, especially. Yeah. It's one thing if I'm fighting the boss and it takes me a long time to kill the boss. That's expected.
Okay, a boss character, yeah, but like I don't need to be hitting no henchman in the head five times with a sniper rifle for him to go down.
That's like playing Halo and you got to freaking unload six clips into a freaking grunt. It makes no sense.
Yeah, nah, man.
Makes no sense.
Nah, dude. And like these guys, they're humans, and that's my thing is that these are humans that are just like absorbing all of this damage.
Wearing hoodies with a plexiglass shield, what the hell?
Freaking crazy, man.
But yeah, that.
So I'm actually surprised, and well, not surprised. No, yeah, I'm surprised that they're doing this instead of like pushing out the next DLC pack because it shows that they want people to enjoy the game. Right.
I think the game, the thing is, it did good. It sold real well. And
it sold like hotcakes.
So they want to bring it back because I'm sure they want to bank. You know, Ubisoft and their infinite sequels. So
they want to bank off of this.
Right.
And aren't they coming up with another game that's like super similar that is like in the Safari? Instead?
Yeah, that's the Tom Clancy game.
Man, it's like
I can't think of the name of it right now, but.
But that's like the same thing. It looks very similar.
It seems to me that's more open world thinking. Like I'm thinking like more like GTA type open world versus, or maybe even closer like Far Cry.
Yeah, Wildlands.
Wildlands. Yeah.
I'm actually like, cause I mean that it looks cool, looks great, but I'm actually very. I'm like holding off on.
I'm telling you something. Ubisoft has one more time. They've been burning me. Assassin's Creed. We'll talk about more.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in the long form. So
yeah.
So let's just go ahead and move on to the next story, and we'll get back to Ubisoft here in a second. So our last story for the week we talked about this earlier in the podcast was the Games for Gold, service for Xbox Live. And they are coming strong with some heavy hitters for the month of September.
Yeah, definitely. So they have two, as always, it's two Xbox One games and mm-hmm. two Xbox 360 games. The first game is Earthlock Festival of Magic. That's going to be available starting September 1st and it's available all month.
Uh-huh.
First, it's a RPG. Is developed by Snowcastle Games.
Looks good.
Yeah, it looks really good. And from my understanding, this is a brand new game. It's being released on the 1st.
Oh, wow.
It's not been previously released. So it's a brand new game. Turn-based RPG. Think along the lines of like your standard type of a JRPG type game, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks really good, and it's free.
Yeah, I watched the trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't do too many RPGs, but Games for Gold has been getting me into playing more RPGs. Like I played this one. I can't remember what it was.
Bama Saga. They just released that one a couple of months. Last month, this month, or the month before?
This was a few months ago. I think it was called, like, I can't remember what it's called. I think it's called Child of Light or something.
Child of Light. Yeah, that game is good.
Oh my God, that game is so good. Yeah, Child of Light, and that was the only reason. And you know, it was to a point where I was like, wow, like I just played this entire. I did not deserve to get that for free. I should have paid money for that because that is a solid game, and I really feel like. This Earthlock is gonna be
right.
Very solid. So I am definitely anticipating that. I'm waiting on that. The next game that's gonna be on the Xbox One, and that's gonna start on September the 16th, and that's gonna go all the way into October the 15th.
Right, that's Assassin's Creed Chronicles.
Yeah, and that's the Assassin's Creed Chronicles. And
if you're not familiar with Assassin's Creed Chronicles, it's basically a 2D side scroller, 2.5D side scroller, Assassin's Creed game. I played the demo on not this one. There's another one that I played.
I think they had another one.
Yeah, there's another one I played, but I played that one and it's interesting. It's free. If it's not free, it's like $10. It's an arcade game. It's a different character, different assassin. I'm going through the standard Assassin's Creed, but it's a side scroller, 2D. There's some instances where you're running in front of a door, you can jump in and hide to snatch up a guard.
Yeah, so there was a game, another 2D game that was very similar. I can't remember what it was called. Me and my memory. I can't remember what it was called, but yeah, I think I'll play this one just because I do like. Side scrollers. I love side scrollers, and anytime that you can do a side scroller with like stealth mechanics, it's most times a good time.
Right.
So I'll definitely be picking that one up when that's available as well. And then on the 360 side, and like we said earlier, these games are going to be available on the Xbox One as well. So right. If you don't have your 360 anymore, it don't matter. It don't even matter, baby. You still getting the 360 games. And what they have starting on September the 1st all the way to the 15th is Forza Horizon.
Which it's basically Forza dressed up as a Need for Speed type game.
So it's not necessarily a simulator,
right.
But I wouldn't necessarily call it like an arcade type racer either. It's
somewhere in between.
Yeah.
But the thing is, one thing about Forza, any of the Forza games, I have 5, I have 6. I haven't played any of the Horizon. I've played like a demo, but I didn't bother buying it. But beautiful, beautiful game. It's free. If you like racing, if you like arcade type racing, arcade simulation type racing, think Need for Speed, think The Crew, think even like Burnout type game. It's one of those type of things where it's kind of open world. You race to certain, you go to certain points in the map, and you get races to do. You get races. There's secret shortcut paths, secret paths to go to take shortcuts. It's fun, and it's fun. Forza Horizon 3 is coming out, and that one, if I'm not mistaken, is going to be an HDR game, which. My game sharing partner is getting that, so I'm going to enjoy playing that in fabulous HDR on my 1S. But,
your 1S.
Yeah, my 1S. Yeah, but it's a good game. And if you haven't played any of the Forza games and you have an Xbox One, definitely give it a shot because I believe you'll probably enjoy it.
Yeah.
You'll probably enjoy it, especially if you're an arcade racer.
Yeah, so I'll definitely be checking that one out. I haven't played a racing game with like actual cars since what was the last one I played? I played Blur and Split Second. Those are the last two I played. I played those at the exact same time. But since then, it's been Mario Kart and Sonic and All-Stars Racing. Those have been my only racing games since then. And so it'll be refreshing to get back into it, and I get to do it for free, baby. Oh, yeah. Yep. And so the last game on the 360 side and this is going to be released on September the 16th and be available until the end of the month on the 30th, is the original Mirror's Edge. So and if you haven't played it, this will be the perfect opportunity.
It's definitely an interesting game. I have the new one. I actually bought it when they had the summer sale because it was on sale for like 50% or 65% off. It was like, yeah, which I think was crazy. I paid 25 or 30 bucks for it. And I always wanted to try Mirror's Edge. I guess I should have waited a couple of months. But I will say this. The game is fun. It takes a bit getting used to because it's basically Assassin's Creed in first person.
Yeah, it's a first person kind of, I wouldn't necessarily say like stealth game, although yeah, you do kind of want to stay hidden,
right? But where I reference right is the parkour, the walk running, yeah, the jumping, that is that portion of Assassin's Creed, I should say. Yeah, because it's not fully stealth and all that. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely the wall running and the jumping and the parkour is pretty much like Assassin's Creed. And to be quite honest, a lot of the controls, once you get used to it, the controls kind of work a bit like Assassin's Creed when you want to do your runs and your jumps and your swings and hopping points. It's actually very interesting. It's fun. It's pretty fun.
Yeah. I mean, I played the original. I never beat it. So mm-hmm, this will be an opportunity for me to pick it back up. I didn't buy it. I actually like borrowed the game from somebody. So yeah, it'll be cool to pick it back up. And then maybe if it goes back on sale or, it, you know, depending on how much it costs, I may get Mirror's Edge Catalyst. I may pick that one up later. But yeah, some very solid titles this month for Games for Gold.
Yep, definitely.
I swear to God, if Sony comes out with another goddamn space game for PlayStation Plus, I mean, come on, man.
Yeah, I haven't seen an announcement for the PlayStation Plus games this month.
Yeah, they haven't announced it. They haven't announced it yet. Everybody's talking about, you know, the price hikes and all that involved with PlayStation Plus.
Right.
But they have not announced the free games.
It's not out yet. It'll be out before the end of the week for sure.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll probably get it tomorrow. And we'll post it on our Facebook page. So definitely, if you guys follow us on Facebook or like us on Facebook, then you'll see that there once they release that information. But with that said, we're going to go ahead and jump into the long form discussion. And we're going to get back on Ubisoft and their problems with releasing games, not only on PC, but just like releasing like AAA games in general.
Yeah. So, well, and to be fair, this can go to many of the other publishers, definitely, as well. But Ubisoft has been the poster child for bad releases.
Yeah.
I mean, it got to the point where Assassin's Creed, they had to give away the season pass or the game free, mm-hmm, to placate people from how broken that game was. And I have that Assassin's Creed. I actually wound up getting Just Dance because my 6-year-old wanted a dance game. So I got Just Dance with the broken Assassin's Creed game. Because I've always been a big Assassin. The only Assassin's Creed game I really didn't like was 3.
3. 3 was terrible.
The one with the Native American. But all the other Assassin's Creed, especially Black Flag and the Assassin's Creed 2 Brotherhood was one of my favorites.
Brotherhood is my jam. You know, and the thing is, I went on like a Assassin's Creed binge. Mm-hmm. Like I was binge playing like all the games. It was summer. At the time I was unemployed, and so I was like, you know what, we're gonna go through and we're gonna play all these games. I got a couple of them like really cheap, so I went through. I didn't play the first one because everybody says just like skip the first one,
right?
But I went through every single one, and then Unity was actually on the brink of being released, so I got it when it came out. Mm-hmm. And I think I still have those videos. This is the first one on the current generation of consoles, and like I still have the videos like on my DVR of like me falling through the floor, infinitely just like falling through the floor, can't do anything, just like game breaking, you know, glitches and bugs, and I just gave up, man.
That's an Ubisoft thing, because there's a couple other games that does that. The Division notoriously did that for a while, where you would just randomly fall through the floor, and you would fall and fall. You actually, so you'd be in a mission, say you're in the mission, you grouped up with four people, you start falling through the floor, and you'll fall through the floor until you're out of the mission, and then when you finally die, they'll put you back into one of the safe houses, the closest safe house or the last safe house you were in, and you had to teleport back to your team. It was very odd. But apparently falling through the floor is something Ubisoft is prolific at.
Yeah. I remember falling through the floor in like GTA San Andreas. I remember that was a thing back in the day. But that was like when your disc was like not clean. And like it wouldn't load like portions of the map and you just like fall through the floor. But I remember that was a thing. But yeah, so I mean, it's gotten to the point where Assassin's Creed is actually... Like they skipped out on a year. They like, you know, we're not gonna, because they've been releasing Assassin's Creed games every single year.
Right.
And this has been the first year where we're not getting an Assassin's Creed. Right.
They've replaced the Assassin's Creed release this year with Watch Dogs, because Watch Dogs 2 has been released in the Assassin's Creed window.
Yeah.
And I found that interesting, but it makes sense because the past two Assassin's Creed games have been disasters.
Well, I didn't really think Syndicate was all that bad.
It's just got a bad rep. So the game release wasn't bad. It's actually pretty good. But the problem was they had such a bad rep from Unity that it drug Syndicate down.
Yeah.
You know?
And there was actually one that I didn't play because I remember at the same time they released Unity, they released Rogue on 360. Yeah, that's the only one I haven't played, and I haven't heard.
Nobody's played that because it was sitting on 360.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know why they, like, they really think I'm gonna buy two like Assassin's Creed games. It's like, damn, I barely have enough time to play one.
This right here, Games with Gold, please.
We need Rogue, man, because I want to play it, but I don't want to buy it.
Yeah, I heard it's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, they still had the sailing and everything from Assassin's Creed of Black Flag.
Black Flag, yep. I don't understand why they did that. That didn't make much sense to me.
I mean, I guess because at the time, you know, the Xbox One was still pretty new. Not everybody had it. Not a huge install base. But, so they wanted to give an Assassin's Creed to everybody, you know?
Yeah, but they released Black Flag for both systems. They released Black Flag for Xbox One and 360.
Why would they? I don't know. I don't know.
It's odd, but...
Yeah, that was an odd decision, kind of like splitting the base like that.
Yeah, they did that, but yeah, whatever. But yeah, they've just constantly are having problems, and on top of them having problems, we just talked about the Division One. They had major problems, even just gameplay in general. Not even glitches, just poorly designed gameplay. And they take a long time to address or fix. I don't know if they can't fix them. They have a hard time fixing them. At least with the PC version of... No, that's not Ubisoft. Scratch that. But they tend to take a long time to fix their issues.
Yeah, because like you said before, with them like trying to fix the game, like Division has been out for a while.
Since March.
So...
Well, 6 months.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I guess they feel like it's worth it because they're actually going through with it instead of, you know, giving people, you know, what they, you know... What they would probably want to give is, you know, increase the lifespan of the game with more DLC. You know, they're actually going to address problems with the game. But 6 months after launch, it's like...
My thing with Division is this new IP. They figure they have a hit on their hands. And before they lose it outright, they want to get it fixed to try to freshen it up.
Okay, so I can understand it from that aspect.
That's what I think it is with that. But my problem is, I mean, we can go down a list. The Crew, bad release.
The launch for The Crew was terrible.
Yeah, I mean, even Watch Dogs. I remember Watch Dogs, and Watch Dogs wasn't.
I didn't think it was a bad game. I think it was them, you know, given
over-promising,
under-delivering,
but even then they have first day patches. I mean, if it's not an Ubisoft game if it doesn't have a day one patch, and they're usually pretty big patches, they're not small patches, and there always seem to be some kind of major issue in their games. I don't understand why. I don't know if I can't imagine, because they have a very talented development team, under them. My assumption is that the developers are being rushed to push out the games to meet quarterly, so they can hit their quarterly earnings, so they can meet, they can have the games out to sell and make the shareholders happy. But it's really it's hurting their reputation very bad.
I agree, and like I've always been a fan of Ubisoft games since back in the day, because you know I've always played Rayman. Yeah. And so I that's what I associate Ubisoft with, is like, you know, them old school PS2 games, you know, Dreamcast games. So, you know, with everything that they're going through right now, it's definitely tarnishing their reputation, and I'm not sure if cuz right now in my mind I'm feeling like I want to hold off on what's it called, on Wildlands, just cuz just because of everything that's been going on with the rest of their games.
The same thing with Watch Dogs, cuz I had Watch Dogs. I actually beat the shit out of Watch Dogs.
Okay.
I'm kind of excited for Watch Dogs 2, but I'm also a little bit concerned.
Yeah, I'm just concerned. It's like, wow, oh man, is it going to Is it going to be like the same thing over again? Like, I don't know. I'll probably play Watch Dogs 2. I didn't have a problem with the first one. Yeah, I didn't have a problem with it, so I'll probably pick it up.
Right.
But it's like, for me to just jump into, because like I've never really played, what is that, the Tom Clancy games? Never really got into those, except for Splinter Cell. I did play Splinter Cell, and they need to bring that shit back, son.
Yeah.
The last one was, oh, it's great.
Yeah, I wasn't a huge, Rainbow Six was my game.
I never Rainbow played Rainbow Six.
Rainbow Six Vegas and Rainbow Six Vegas 2 were, I mean, those games I put a lot of time in.
That was a game was for gold a couple months ago.
Yeah, I already had those because I bought the Rainbow Six Siege Collector's Edition. Came with both of those.
Okay,
yeah.
That's dope.
Yeah, but Rainbow Six Siege, I really didn't like. I know it's popular. I know a lot of people play. In my opinion, the gunplay is poor. It's like last gen.
I don't even get it, man. I thought it was gonna be one of those like really like competitive, like almost like intimidating style like competitive games. Cause I don't know. I just don't like it. You got like the little like creep around with the. To creep around the corners with your gun. Like,
yeah.
I don't know.
Lean over. Yeah, I like the destructibility, but it doesn't feel like a current generation game. It feels a bit, if it's slow, the frame rate seems a little bit slow. I don't know. It was disappointing. I would just say, leave it there. It's just a bit disappointing. Just like most of the other stuff. The thing is, I've noticed Ubisoft, like I said, with Watch Dogs, they overpromise and underdeliver. They make these huge overarching demonstrations and they put a lot of hype. These big, huge presentations, and they talk about it and they show these pretty videos.
Yeah.
And it's not unusual for Ubisoft to show a game that looks amazing, and the game they delivered is nothing like it.
Yeah.
The graphics are downgraded. That's something that they've done a couple of times now. I don't know what their deal is. Maybe because they're French.
Maybe, I don't know. I mean, the only thing they have to do for me is release another Rayman, and we're back on good terms, baby. Give me some more Rayman. Because they have a few games up and coming, and it's like I'm kind of going to just like keep my distance on just about all of them.
Right.
They have that open world like extreme like winter sports game that's steep. It's called Steep.
Steep. Yeah, yeah.
So I don't think I'm gonna pick that up. They have like a melee combat type game with the what's that? For Honor.
Yeah, For Honor. That's coming out. That looks pretty good, but like you said, it's a
new idea for them. Something that they've never done before. So I wonder if it's gonna have like the same like kind of like it's, problems.
Right. I mean, yeah, they have a lot of that. Like you said, Steep. They have the Ghost Recon Wildlands coming out for Honor, which actually it looks very interesting and it's pretty looking, but I don't know.
I'm just not sure.
They have South Park, The Fractured Bull Hole.
Oh, I'm positive that's gonna be a banger right there, because I haven't played the first one.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard nothing but good things about it, and this is probably just gonna be more of the same instead of like being based off of. Like Like, I, what was the story? It was like you were like a king, like kingdoms and stuff, like medieval times. It's going to be based off of like superheroes and stuff like that. So it's going to be more of the same. It's an RPG set in the world of South Park. So I feel like that's going to hold up. That's going to be strong. Otherwise, they probably wouldn't have launched a sequel so quickly.
So quickly, with the Matt and Trey still, they have a lot of input in it. So
I think that's what's carrying.
What carries it? Yeah, that I expect that to be fine. But For Honor looks great. I'm hesitant. Ghost Recon, I love Ghost Recon. I've always liked Ghost Recon, but.
Wildlands looks like a game that I would actually play, though. Mm-hmm. That's the thing.
Yeah,
it's like, do I want to take the risk of it being ass?
And that's the problem with Ubisoft right there. Because so then you have two issues with that. Because Ghost Recon is going to be PvP, right? So if you wait too long, by the time you get in it, you get your face smashed. But then you jump in right away, and it's butt, and now you're out $60. So. What do you do, right?
Yeah. What do you do?
Something like For Honor, something like Watch Dogs, even Steep, even South Park. Most of those are they're mainly single player story type games.
Yeah. Well, so, For Honor looks like a fighting game. So I'm not sure. It may have like some kind of like PvP aspect to it.
Right. But yeah. So when you get to the PvP games, if you wait. It might be too late for you to actually get into it, and you might as well not get in anyway. Single player games is not that big of an issue because I mean it's just single player. You can always go pick up a single player game and play it and be done.
Probably out of all of the ones that are coming up, I'll probably get Watch Dogs 2.
Yeah, I'm definitely I had a ton of fun. As much as people complain about how it wasn't like I said, I didn't have high expectations for Watch Dogs. That maybe
I think that's what saved me from like hating it. It's just I didn't like feed into right. the hype.
Yeah, I didn't have, and I think that's what it's just like it saved me. So Watch Dogs 2 is something I probably will get. The good thing is it's coming out in November, so I'll probably wait till around Black Friday when it's on sale because it'll go on sale.
Yeah, it'll go on sale,
and I'll get it around there. Ghost Recon is something I'm definitely going to be.
I want to try it, man. I watched the demos and mm-hmm. The gameplay that came out of E3 and everything, and it's like, man, it looks fun.
Yeah, it does.
It looks fun. It definitely does. Something I would like to play with friends and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. For Honor is interesting.
I don't think I'm gonna get that one.
I will have to see more of that. I will actually want to play a demo or something.
Yeah.
But other than that, I mean, they have Just Dance coming out. I'll probably wind up getting that just because my daughter, she likes to play it with her friends.
for the little.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes she talks me into making a fool of myself. But.
Aww.
No. But other than that.
But yeah, they're definitely going to have to come with their A game for these next games, especially for the two that. They have the least experience, making games, and it's their new IPs.
The new IPs, right.
They're going to really have to bring their A game for these new IPs because so far, all of their new IPs have had very, mixed reviews or mixed, launches. Their launches have, not been the best for any of their new IPs.
Right.
So...
Yeah, we'll see.
On one side, you have to kind of applaud Ubisoft for coming out with so many fresh and new ideas. They have to capitalize on it.
Yeah, they have to actually execute.
They have to execute properly.
Because it is refreshing when we look at Activision and the umpteenth Call of Duty game and EA Sports. I mean, excuse me, EA, and all they're doing is freaking Battlefield and Madden and FIFA every year. And so it is definitely refreshing that there are new IPs.
When was the last time we had a snowboarding game? Like, geez.
Was it? What's it called? What was the game?
SSX Tricky? Last one I played. On the PlayStation 2.
SSX, that's right. So I'm rooting for
Ubisoft. It's just they're really gonna have to, step it up, man.
They need to stop over promising. They need to bring themselves down to earth. I know it's your game and you're very excited. You guys are mm-hmm. doing great things, and you feel like your game is going to be the greatest game.
Hyping it up on stage with Alicia Tyler, man.
Keep that internally and just tell us you think you have a good game that everybody's going to enjoy. Don't tell us oh my gosh, this Watch Dogs 2 is going to be the greatest open first person, the greatest third person open world game you've ever played. You're going to forget about. No, don't tell me that. Just say, hey, we have Watch Dogs 2 coming out. It's going to be a very solid game. You will enjoy it. And yeah. if it's great, we'll tell you it's great. Don't, yeah. you shouldn't tell us it's great. Let us tell you it's great.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but yeah, I'm definitely rooting for him. Let's get into our final thoughts. Is there anything that you want to add to any of the topics or anything else that you would like to say before we close out of here?
My final thought, based on everything we talked about, one thing is, I people don't complain about the price hike on PlayStation Plus. I mean, it's $10 a year, and not $10 a month. So you're paying $6 a year, $5 a month. If you really have a problem with that, there may be other things you need to get in order. But I think it's still a good value.
Still a good value, not as good a value as Xbox Live.
No.
That's what I'm going to say.
Unfortunately, if you're on the PS4 and you're waiting for backwards compatibility, it's possible you can get it. I don't think it'd be coming anytime soon.
Yeah.
Unless they do hardware emulation like they did with the PS3 way back in the day. Remember the first PS3s had the PS2 hardware in it.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, so... I think that's about it. I'm good there.
Yeah, we're good there. Yeah, I agree with you on most of those points. I'm definitely rooting for Ubisoft. And so I don't know. I think PlayStation Now is a terrible idea. Yeah, yeah. Especially on PC.
PlayStation Now.
That's stupid.
Yeah, skip that.
Don't buy into that.
That gets zero recommendation.
Yeah, you got 0 out of 10.
Yeah,
definitely. that's where I'm going to end it. You guys should definitely like us on Facebook and follow us on our Twitter. We pretty much update everything, especially like the main stories that we're going to be talking about during each show. You can see that on our Facebook page. So definitely like us there. Give them all the podcast news, all the podcast like links and stuff. So, where can they hear us?
Definitely our podcast is live on iTunes. It's on Google Play. It's on TuneIn Radio. If you're an Android user, go to Google Play, download us, rate us. Go to iTunes, download us, give us some ratings. Let us know how we're doing. We'll look at your comments, and if they're rude, we'll just delete it. But yeah, we'll listen. We'll take it to heart. You know?
And we also have a very shoddy YouTube page that I'm doing a terrible job at managing. But I'm gonna get my shit together soon. So you should follow to see the progress.
Yeah, we're slowly building up. Just working.
Slowly building up. So you guys should definitely keep in touch with us. Keep track of what we're doing and what we're talking about on all of our social medias. But with that said, we're going to go ahead and get up out of here. My name is Trenell, and I'm here with Todd, but everybody knows his name is...
Up Jump the Boogie.
I say Up Jump the... Yeah, and we will see you guys next week. Peace out.